Hey there, everyone! So, a lot of people requested sort of a making of for my Life as a Bokoblin video, which is what you're watching right now. It'll be available early for my Patreons and members, so if you're among those watching this early, I'd like to say hi, and thank you for your support. This will be a lot more casual and freeform than my other videos. It's just gonna be me talking about the process and sharing some behind-the-scenes recordings, hopefully without stumbling too much. Some of the stuff I'll be covering includes where I got the idea in the first place, the script writing, the voiceover, the capturing process, editing, music, and some final thoughts in the end. So, let's just dive straight into it. I've been sitting on the idea for this video for quite a long time, actually. As early as the summer of last year, even before the release of Paper Mario The Origami King. As you can see from this screenshot of me talking about the project to Nintendo Black Crisis on Discord on June 28th. I even already called it Life as a Bokoblin, even back then. The biggest reason I held off on the project for so long was due to a couple of things. First off was technical limitations, which I will elaborate further on in the section where we talk about the capturing process. But the gist of it is that I simply didn't know how I could get the footage I wanted. In fact, I didn't even find what I was looking for to make the video possible until mid-October of last year or something. Second was the release of Age of Calamity. Even before I started to find ways to get the footage, Age of Calamity was announced, so obviously I felt like it wasn't the right time for a video like this. I mean, why do a Breath of the Wild video if you have a brand new game coming out which everyone is hyped for? So by that point I already realized that this was probably gonna be a 2021 project. Which leads into the script. Now I'm not gonna do a whole tutorial on script writing or anything like that. I don't consider writing to be my strong point, and frankly, this script was actually a big challenge for me, since, well, I've never written something like this before. Normally I just have a theory or analysis and I just write down the explanation in a somewhat cohesive narrative. This was the first time I had to write an actual story, so to say. Even before writing, I already had some ideas set in stone. I knew I wanted the story to revolve around proving yourself to the clan, being an outcast and then slowly gaining their trust, which is obviously inspired by stories like Pocahontas, Avatar, and The Last Samurai. You know, the classic story about an outsider who's used to modern conveniences and then befriending a more native group or tribe. Dances with Wolves is another one of those. Some other things I already had in mind were the hunting scene with the boar, the idea of Link dancing and celebrating alongside the Bokoblins at the fire, not being allowed to sleep at the campfire because they don't trust you, and then ultimately gaining their trust because you end up catching a meal for them. All that stuff was basically already there in my mind before I even put a single word on paper. Even the idea of one of the Bokoblins warming up to you and becoming kind of like your friend throughout the story was something I already came up with early on, which is where the idea for Larry came to be. Now, the name Larry wasn't set or anything like that. While I was writing, I just kind of realized it would be funny if one of them had a very human name compared to the others. So I settled on Larry, which was just a random choice, honestly. He could have just as well been called Steve or Mike had I felt differently that day. Oh, and Gray was actually supposed to be called Blue in my original idea, but in my save file, there were no longer any blue Bokoblins on the Great Plateau. I also didn't want to start a completely new save file and get the Bokoblin mask all over again and such, so Blue simply became Gray. Before I got into the production and I was still conceptualizing, I actually had a very different Bokoblin camp in mind. For some reason, I constantly pictured this one close to the Great Plateau Tower. I don't know why, but that's just how it looked in my imagination. This ended up changing because I realized that, first of all, I didn't want too many Bokoblins involved. I wanted to keep the group relatively small. Having only three of them just made it a lot more manageable. And less than three also wouldn't work, since then I couldn't do the whole naming joke. Well, I could, but it wouldn't be as funny and unexpected if it was just Gray and Larry. I wanted to have that third step of Gray, Red, and Larry. It just works better. It also isn't much of a tribe if there's only two. Second was the fact that some of the camps, including this one, have these little watchtowers, and the Bokoblins on the towers don't really do anything. They just stand there, looking around. And more importantly, they don't sleep at night. I wanted all of them to talk and sleep and dance and have some involvement in the story, which I couldn't do with these Bokoblins. So all the camps with the little watchtowers were out of the question. There were a couple of camps I was considering, like this one in the mountains, which ended up not working as well because of the cold temperature. It makes Link constantly shiver and take damage. I knew pretty early on that I wanted Link to wear the old shirt and trousers, which don't protect against the cold. The reason I wanted these clothes in particular was because they don't have any decorations on them. No patterns or symbols and stuff like that. So when you dye them, they become a solid red color. I also briefly considered having Link be naked and only wearing the mask, but I thought the red clothing was more fitting. Plus, I wanted to do this little bit where the narrator is like, "Using the latest in stealth technology, we have concocted a clever disguise, and then showing the whole dying process. It just ended up working better. I also wanted the camp to be reasonably close to ground level, since narrative-wise that would work a lot better with the whole going out and hunting and gathering resources and stuff, which is a bit harder atop a mountain somewhere. I ended up settling on this camp because it had the right number of bokoblins, and because it had a cooking pot, which actually wasn't going to be part of the narrative, but as soon as I saw it, I realized, yeah, I can do something with that. Maybe have Link fix up some food for the bokoblins or something. Like I said, the core idea was already there, but that was mostly the beginning and the end. The hard part was filling out the bits in between. I mean, there has to be sort of a build-up to it. So that's where all the other stuff came in, like cooking food and cleaning the camp, gathering mushrooms, all that good stuff. Like I said, I sat on this script for quite a while. Normally I write my script in barely a few days, but this one took me around 2 or 3 weeks before I was satisfied. And unlike my other scripts, I knew that this one had to be perfect since I wasn't gonna do the voiceover myself. Which brings us to the voiceover. Like all the other core ideas, I decided from the start that I wanted to frame the video as if it was a nature documentary. That's pretty much what the whole idea was built around. And I also quickly realized that I would probably have to hire a voice actor to do it. As far as nature documentaries go, obviously David Attenborough is one of, if not the first person that comes to mind. I've always been a big fan of David. The way he speaks and explains stuff is just very calming and has a certain elegance to it. I cannot do a British accent like that. Heck, I already have a hard enough time not letting my Dutch accent shine through. This video would have only worked as a nature documentary if it actually sounds like one too. I of course did try to imitate David Attenborough's voice.
Us humans have lived on this planet for millennia. We thrive as a species, and yet have lost our touch with the wild.
But it just sounds forced in my opinion, and it's obviously a younger person trying to do an older person's voice. Like Impa in Breath of the Wild.
I am much older now. But you remember me, don't you?
So I did what many people who want a voiceover do and jumped onto Fiverr, which is where I found a man named The British Voice Artist, or British Voice Art. I was immediately sold by his demo. It just sounded perfect right from the get-go. I of course did check out a couple of other options too, but not only was his impression just the best in my opinion, he was, interestingly enough, also more affordable than some of the others. I wasn't necessarily fixated on price, but I just found it funny that his was so good and yet others were much more expensive even though they were less spot on. And well, I mean, he ended up doing a phenomenal job. And when he saw the final result, he ended up really liking the video. So when I do another one of these, you can be assured that he will be back too. While I waited for the voiceover to arrive, it was finally time to start capturing, which was by far the most time-consuming part of the production, and probably the thing people are most interested in to see. So one important thing to note, yes, this video was made using mods. Remember how I said that I held off on the project because I didn't know how to get the footage? Well, that's where the mods came into play. This video would have literally been impossible to make without it. I'm not gonna get into the specifics on how to set up mods or where to get them, because I don't want this video to turn into a tutorial on how to mod. There are plenty of sources out there who explain how it all works and how to set it up, yada yada yada. So I will only explain which mods were relevant for the making of this video and a basic description of what they do. The first one is a first person mod, which kind of speaks for itself. Back in the old days, the only way you could create a shot without having Link in the shot was to run up to a wall or obstacle and then pan the camera towards that object, which makes his character model disappear. I still use this technique on some occasions in the video, mostly out of convenience. But as you can imagine, the options are very limited, as there is not always something nearby you can use. I've even gone as far as to use a remote bomb to get it done, courtesy of Nintendo Black Crisis, who taught me that technique. But as you can see, you still have to deal with the fact that you can see blue particles flying into the frame. The first person mod simply gives me more flexibility and allows me to capture any footage from anywhere I want, without having to worry about that. It also gives you the option to capture footage while paragliding, which allows for these beautiful looking high altitude landscape shots. Second is the Oblivious Enemies mod, made by The Bread Pirate. This mod single-handedly made the entire video possible. The first-person stuff I could have probably worked around. It would have severely limited the options in terms of camera angles, but at least it would have still been doable. But the Oblivious Enemies mod was absolutely crucial to make this happen. The reason for this is that even when you're wearing the bokoblin mask, it is still impossible to make the bokoblins ignore you. They will stand there endlessly investigating you. The only thing you can really do is stay out of their line of sight sight, but that means there's no way to get any shots from up close, nor does it allow for Link to be in the presence of Bokoblins while they go about their normal routines. So that shot I imagine from the very start where Link is dancing at the fire with the Bokoblins, that goes out the window, since by jumping up and down you make sound, which will immediately attract their attention. The mod makes enemies totally ignore Link altogether, no matter where he stands or how much sound he makes. You can still get their attention and get them to stop what they're doing, but we'll get into that later. Lastly is a very minor one, but still pretty important for the overall immersion. A mod which was actually custom made for the video by Waikuteru, who you may remember as the guy who created a whole Skyward Sword dungeon inside Breath of the Wild. Very talented guy. One of my biggest gripes about capturing enemies, aside from the fact that they try to attack you, has always been this little thing right here. The white arrow that shows up on top when you try to get even remotely close to them. I wanted this video to look and feel like a documentary, which means I wanted as little HUD elements visible as possible. I don't know, I just felt like it ruined the experience seeing this thing hovering above their heads the whole time. So I hit up Waikuteru, who was kind enough to make a quick little tweak which hides the arrow altogether. We also tried to get rid of the question and exclamation mark, but this turned out to be harder than we thought, and would actually crash the whole game as soon as I got close to an enemy. I'm sure he could have fixed this issue eventually, but I didn't want to take up too much of his time. Plus, it was such a rare occurrence anyway, I just left it as it is. Now, normally when I capture footage for a video, I just go through the script and make a list of anything I need to capture. I then arrange it all based on location. So, say for instance, I want to capture the 8th heroine, Gerudo Town, and some other shots in the desert, I will pool those together. This reduces the amount of times I need to fast travel from place to place, and also allows me to split it up into multiple recordings, and keep things organized. Especially when you're capturing for hours upon end, it's nice to take a break in between. Before I could even capture anything regarding the Bokoblins, I first wanted to get everything else out of the way. Footage from outside the Great Plateau. So I have a recording with all the little survival stuff in the opening segment, recordings of Hateno Village, a collection of sunrises, random landscapes, various wildlife, Hylians interacting with Bokoblins, the part where I dye Link's clothing, basically anything that doesn't take place in and around the Great Plateau itself. Then I have a whole batch of recordings from inside the Bokoblin camp, and a few separate recordings for the hunting segment inside the forest. Some shots I already had in mind before I started recording, but there's also a lot of improvising involved, where I just aimlessly run around and see if I can find some interesting shots and good angles. Oh, and when it comes to some of the landscape shots, like I said before, I just paraglide around. But even with the first person mod, there's still some limitations, of course, as this isn't a free cam. You can't really paraglide upwards, at least not slow and steady. The only way to get a slow upward panning shot is to either climb, or what I sometimes do is just drift down slowly and then reverse the footage. This doesn't always work, of course. For instance, if there is a waterfall in the shot, the water will be flowing upwards, which looks weird. When it came to recording the Bokoblin camp itself, there's one thing that made recording all this stuff a little bit more difficult, and that is that the Oblivious Enemies and First Person mod cannot be turned on and off at will while you're playing. You need to exit and restart the game for them to take effect, or lose their effect. This meant that I first had to determine and list all the shots I wanted to capture and then group them together based on which mods are required. Because, you know, sometimes I want Link to be in the shot, sometimes I don't, sometimes I want the Bokoblins to react to my presence, other times I want them to ignore me. And I didn't want to constantly capture something, turn a specific mod on or off, restart the game, wait for the loading screens, and then capture the next part. That would be very tedious and time consuming. So I had to group all the captures together based on the combination of the two mods. So first person on, Oblivious Enemies off, both of them turned on, first person off, Oblivious Enemies on, and both of them turned off. This way I could capture all specific shots continuously, then stop the recording and change the mod setup, and then record the next batch. The only problem that came with this approach was that you can't record footage chronologically. I know this is actually quite normal. For instance, movies are never shot chronologically. They record all the footage that takes place in one specific location and then move to the next one and shoot everything there. But at least then you have a whole team of people and someone who keeps track of all the scenes and shots. For one person, this is a bit harder to do. And I haven't even mentioned that I also needed to keep in mind all the sections which take place in the morning, or at night, or midday. I also needed to constantly keep Link's appearance in mind, like which weapons he should be carrying, if any at all. For instance, in the scene where Link is cooking, I had to light the fire underneath the cooking pot first. And then I forgot to unequip his flame sword, which he shouldn't have. I didn't notice this until the video was already up, but oh well. mistakes were made. As for the interactions with the Bokoblins, there was a lot of stuff that went into making them do what I wanted them to do. The final video you saw is only a very small fraction of all the time I spent trying to get the footage I wanted. I'm actually happy I kept all the raw recordings, because a lot of the time I trim out all the unnecessary stuff straight from the capture program. Stuff like walking from place to place, fast traveling, fumbling around to get a good angle, and all the other things that can go wrong trying to get a specific shot, like stealth enemies spawning at unwanted moments. But the recordings for this video were so many and so long, it would have taken me a full day editing out all the unwanted footage. So I decided to just leave it as it is and select the desired footage during the editing process. This did take a lot of space on my hard drive though, like 226 gigs. But hey, at least I get to use some of this stuff in this video. Now, in a lot of cases, I had the Oblivious Enemies mod turned on so I could capture them doing their thing, either with or without Link in the shot. In the case where it seems like Link is talking to the Bokoblins, they are actually just talking to each other. I just planted Link in between them so it looks like they are speaking to him. Oh, and the little hand gestures Link does is something you can trigger by hitting the button for the sword or the bow without having anything equipped. This triggers an animation where he tries to grab his sword or bow and then realizes he doesn't have anything in his hands. But sometimes I needed the Bokoblins to do something specific. Let's take this shot as an example. The one where they're supposed to return from a hunt at the end of the day. Seems rather straightforward, right? Well, here's what I had to do to make this happen. For this footage, I turned off all mods except the white arrow thing, which was always on for obvious reasons. Then I needed to show myself to the Bokoblins without wearing the Bokoblin mask. Why? Well, because that's the only way to get them to pick up their weapons. They are returning from a hunt, so yeah, it makes sense that they would be carrying their spears and clubs and such, right? So after they pick up their weapons, ready to attack me, I had to run away from the camp. Far enough that they would stop giving chase, but not far enough for the camp to unload and reset everything. Then I needed to head back while wearing the mask. That way they would still have their weapons in hand, but they forgot about my previous appearance and once again fell for the disguise. Then I needed to lure them away from the camp and then make like hell and run back into the camp, hug the wall, and get a shot of them walking back into the camp while carrying their weapons. The tricky part here was that I couldn't lure them away too far. The reason being is that if you disappear from their sights completely, they will just stand there and won't return to their camp until you once again let your presence be known, which also triggers the exclamation mark, which I didn't want either. So I had to lure them far enough away that I had some time to set up the shot, but not too far to the point that they lose track of me. All this trouble for a shot lasting only a few seconds in the final film. And there are many, and I mean many, of these moments during my recording. Like this part where Larry had to hold a burning torch as if he was guarding the perimeter, which meant tricking him into grabbing a torch by not wearing the mask, lure the whole group out of the camp, and then somehow try to make everyone except Larry lose track of me. Then having him follow me to the required spot, light his torch with a fire arrow, just to capture this shot right here. And I had to do this a second time in third person for the part where Link and Larry stand guard together. This went wrong on so many occasions, where the others just wouldn't leave me alone, or Larry not picking up the torch, or suddenly running back to the camp while I desperately tried to get his attention by shooting arrows close to him, you name it. Now, you might say, why not just kill the other two so you only have to focus on Larry? Well, first of all, come on, man. Alright, I'm not gonna lie, there were two instances in which I had to kill one or more of them to capture something and then reload my save, because it would have been impossible otherwise. Like the part where Gray wakes up Link and stands there talking to him. The other two had to go, since it's too close to the camp, and all three would have swarmed me. Once one of them sees you, it usually triggers all of them and the whole group starts following you. The only way to get the attention of only one of them is when they're sleeping. Like in this part where I shoot an arrow just close enough to Larry that only he wakes up, which ended up backfiring later anyway, because all of a sudden Gray woke up as well. Anyway, second is the fact that I was afraid that you might see the empty camp in the background. Remember, I didn't know exactly what the shot was gonna look like, and I wanted to make sure that if the camp was visible in the background, you could see the others doing their business. It might have been a bit of an overkill for a shot that lasts only a few seconds, but you know, I like doing things the hard way, I guess. After finally getting the shot of Larry holding the burning torch, I also decided to lure him back into the camp and made him stand in front of the cooking pot, so it looked like he was cooking. There are many more moments like these, all kinds of situations where I try to get them to do a specific thing. The part where they were eating mushrooms was actually quite easy, since even if you have the Oblivious Enemies mod activated, they will still react to food being dropped. So I just fed them some shrooms a couple of times and then recorded them chowing down from a different angle each time. The same thing goes for the celebration scene where I just fed Gray a gourmet steak, since, you know, it kinda looks like the steak hanging above the fire. In some cases, while recording the other camps, one of them would already
already be eating a steak for some reason. I didn't give it to them. It's just how the camp loaded, I guess. I didn't even know this was something they could do until I made the video. Here's another fun thing that happened. Early on in my recordings, I took the seared steak from the camp. You know, because they're not supposed to have a steak at this point. The whole idea was that they were starving because they didn't have a successful hunt in a long time. So I had to make sure it was gone in the majority of the footage. Problem is, I did this before recording the shots of Link and the Bokoblin celebrating at the campfire. And the only way to get the steak to return is a blood moon. And I just, for the life of me, couldn't trigger the blood moon event to happen. I must have spent an hour trying to skip time, killing lots of enemies in hopes that this would somehow speed up the process. Turns out that the blood moon cannot be triggered on command. It's apparently tied to the amount of in-game time that has passed. And because I was constantly reloading save files, I was resetting time as a result as well. It doesn't work when you're inside the menu or the pause screen either. You have to be playing the game. You don't have to be moving or pressing any buttons, luckily, so all I could do was find a safe spot to stand and go do something else for a few hours until the event finally triggered. Looking back, I should have recorded the celebration stuff first and then take the steak away. Lastly, I will touch upon the hunting scene. This is actually the only part of the video which I really wish I could do over. It was already hard enough to get those damn boars to spawn, plus the Oblivious Enemies mod doesn't work on wildlife, only enemies. So I couldn't even get a nice close-up shot of them. And this goes for all the animals in the video, by the way, which were all very hard to capture without scaring them away. Especially squirrels. Squirrels are terrible. And when the narrator says in the video that boars are skittish, that didn't just apply to the fictional story. These bastards just won't let you get close. Even if you're extremely careful and quiet, they still manage to hear you from quite far. And before you know it, they're gone. As a result, it was extremely difficult to create a sequence of events without some inconsistencies. All the walking around and crawling through the bush was easy. But the shots with the boars involved were a nightmare to get right, since every time you had to look for a new one to spawn somewhere else. Then try to approach it, trigger it to run away and give chase. Rinse and repeat. And again, I had to switch between the first person and third person stuff, which also didn't help. In the end, I had to choose between all the footage captured and somehow try to edit in a way that it seems like a sequence of events that match. But there's only so much you can do. You cannot choose where a boar will spawn, or which direction it will run into. And it does show on some occasions. You can clearly see that some shots were taken in completely different spots or during a different time of day even. Like right here, it's clearly nighttime, and then in the next shot, the sky is bright all of a sudden. I even used this shot twice in a row because I simply didn't have any more footage of a boar walking into frame. If I had the chance to do this whole part over, I would have probably spent another few hours to capture more footage. But oh well, what's done is done. As for the part where Larry and the others are also walking around the forest, it goes without saying that these are not the same Bokoblins as the ones from the camp. Enemies seem to have a set perimeter, like a maximum amount of distance they are allowed to traverse outside their camp. After that, they automatically turn around and head back. So there was no way to get them all the way to the forest. Luckily, there are two other Bokoblin camps in this general location, and two stray Bokoblins at the edge of the forest. So I just lured them into the forest and get some shots of them roaming around. And that's about it in terms of capturing. Everything was just a combination of using the two different mods, me trying to trigger or manipulate something with a lot of trial and error, and little perspective tricks and different camera angles to make something look a certain way. So now let's go over the editing real quick. There isn't much to say, honestly. I'm not going to give a whole editing class or anything like that, but the editing was actually the easiest part of the whole production. Since I had a lot of footage and organized it fairly well, it was just a matter of putting the whole thing in order as dictated by the voiceover, like a big puzzle. The only thing I really added are the title screen, texts, 3D models of the Bokoblin mask, and the explosion. And it goes without saying that the explosion is just an effect overlaid on top of the footage. Some even commented on how it looked a little bit too realistic and disconnected from the actual game, which I agree with. Looking back at it now, I would have done it differently. I would probably set off an explosion inside Typhlo Ruins since it's dark there, and then use that to overlay into the footage so it's an actual effect from the game itself. As for the title screen, that's just a simple animation I did in After Effects, with a little flower growing on the logo. Nothing special there. And the Bokoblin mask is simply the original model I took from the game's files, retextured it and then added a couple of camera pans in Blender. Nothing more. As many editors do, I usually either use the voice or the music to determine the timing of the footage. In the opening segment, the clips change based on the rhythm of the drums. And and in the first few shots after the title screen, the footage too changes based on that little ping you hear in the music, until the narration starts, after which the footage is synced to the sentences and context of the voice. As for the music, I wanted to use a mix between calm and floaty songs without drums for the more scenic nature shots, like the ones you often hear in real nature documentaries. And since we're dealing with a primitive tribal setting, songs with mostly percussion and a bit of a jungle vibe. You know, like African Native American tribal music with bongos and stuff. Which is also where I got the idea to use the music from Star Fox Adventures, since I remembered that this game is full of these kinds of primitive sounding tracks. It was also a nice trip down memory lane for myself, since I played this game quite a bit when I was younger. A little fun fact is that I actually got a copyright claim on the video behind the scenes. I accidentally used a track which I thought was free to use. It was even presented that way. But then it turned out that it was just a third party who had stolen the track and pretended like they made it, and then offered it to others as copyright free. So I ended up having to buy the track for $100, no less, just to prevent all the revenue going to the original owner, or having to remove and then re-upload the video with different music, which wasn't really an option either, because by that time the video was already on a roll in terms of views, and would have probably killed that momentum, as well as the fact that all the previous views would be lost. So another lesson learned by me. Always double check and make sure that a track really belongs to the uploader before using it in your video. And by the way, I do buy music on occasion whenever I need something specific, but if I find something good in the copyright free section, I will of course use that too, since if I have to buy every track I use in my videos, I'm gonna go broke real quick. Thank God most video game music is free to use. For now. Anyway, let's finish it up with some stray thoughts and mentions. First, I want to quickly address something that a lot of people have been asking me over and over in my comment section. Yes, I will eventually do another one of these types of videos. Not only was it a lot of fun to make, but it also allowed me to do something else than your typical Zelda theory. And it also got a very warm reception, which, by the way, thank you for that. However, you have to understand that this was an idea that slowly developed over time. I spent a lot of time just chewing on this concept, trying to come up with an interesting narrative, and figuring out how to make it entertaining. And I don't want to just repeat the exact same thing again, but now with Moblins or Lizophos. I'd have to come up with a new, original narrative. This video was a passion project from the start, something I worked on in between my weekly scheduled videos, and the next one will be no different in that regard. I'd rather do something original again than just rehash the same thing. Not to mention, I also gotta save up some money for the voice actor, since if I do another one, I of course want him to make a return as well. Like I said before, he isn't the most expensive voice actor out there, but it was still a pretty big investment nonetheless, especially for a video which I didn't even know was going to perform well. It ended up far exceeding my expectations in terms of performance, but it could have just as well flatlined after 20k and that's it. YouTube can be very unpredictable in that way sometimes. So again, yes, there will be more, but this won't be a video I just churn out in a week or two, so I hope you can have some patience. Looking back at the video now, there are plenty of things I would have done differently or better in hindsight, but I'm still pretty happy with the result. In many ways, it actually turned out better than I had envisioned when the idea first came to me, especially since back then I was still capturing stuff the normal way, and a lot of the shots I had in mind were not possible, for me at least. Anyway, I think that pretty much covers it for now. If you have any more specific questions, feel free to put them down in the comments, and I will try to get to as many as possible. Thank you all so much for your support, your compliments, and of course your criticisms as well, which helps me improve as a creator. And of course, a big thanks to all of my amazing Patreons and members. There are a lot of new faces since the last theory video. So please, if you will, give a big round of applause to Farmy, Hylian Historian, Aaron M, Sarah Knickknack, Calab R Apparel, Calabr Apparel, I don't know man, Star Demon, Stephanie Calling, oh boy, Dominic Gendron Langlois, Langlois? I'm trying here. Daniel Garrett, Julia Sensina, and Adanor. I mean, what else can I say then? Thank you so much for your support. That goes for every last one of you on the list, old and new. Again, thank you so much. In terms of my schedule, I have 4 different projects set to release in the upcoming weeks. One of which being the for now last part of the evolution of Hyrule, a history video about the symbolism in Zelda, a special crossover theory between Zelda and another game, and a collab in late March of which I have yet to decide the subject, but I'll cross that bridge when I come to it. And with that, I bid you all farewell, and hope to see you in the next video. This is Dawn, signing off, and have a good one.